So we got lots of comments last week after we started kicking off this series on life lessons from Ted Lasso. And I just wanted to share with you kind of how I came to watch the show. We had seen some advertisements about it, and Daryl mentioned it. And I have to be honest, I told Daryl, I don't want to watch that. I don't want to watch a show about soccer. I get enough sports in this house anyway. Between professional and college football, professional and college basketball, professional baseball, hockey, soccer, and a one child who's like a walking encyclopedia of all of sports statistics. I have to slow Parker down and go, okay, you gotta help mom out. I don't even know which sport you're talking about. So sport, professional, or college, then give me a team and a player's name. That would be great. So I kept hearing about this series with advertisements and then friends on Facebook, clergy friends, started raving about it, saying there were gospel lessons that were being portrayed. And eventually I thought, all right, I will give in. I will try it. I told Daryl, you get one episode. That's it. And after the episode, I was hooked. And Daryl very graciously didn't say, I told you so much after that. I enjoy it because it's positive and it's hopeful and it's funny and it shows leadership from a different kind of style than what we are used to seeing it get portrayed as. And there were a lot of gospel type lessons being included in the show, like the one that we are focusing in on today with the idea of be curious, not judgmental. Now, Ted Lasso is no Jesus and he's not even Mr. Rogers. But he is intriguing. At first, he comes off as naive, simple, homespun. This Midwestern guy looks like he is going to get eaten alive by the British press and all of the British football fans. But it is in his relationships where Ted draws the most attention. This is the place where he shines. And he offers people something very different than what they've come to expect from a football coach, even an American. Ted is curious. Ted asks questions. Early on in the series, Ted is riding in the back of a cab, and he has a conversation with the driver in which he learns his name and learns that the man's family owns an Indian restaurant. And a couple of episodes later, you see Ted show up at the Indian restaurant and try to eat the really spicy food that he has asked for. And the cab driver sees him there, and he's absolutely flabbergasted because this man drives people around every single day, and he invites every person who gets in his cab to come to his family's Indian restaurant, and Ted is the very first person to ever take him up on it. This is who he is. Ted asks the name of the equipment manager for the team. The poor guy thought he was getting called out to be fired. It's one of the first times anybody had paid attention to him. Nathan. He was just kind of always in the background like furniture before that. People didn't engage with him. Ted treats people well. He knows the name of the young girl who's always playing football in the park just outside of his apartment. He learns the names of all the people in the neighborhood pub, even the ones who make fun of him and are calling him names. He makes friends with the fancy journalist who is spending time with Ted to try and show what a bad coach he is, Trent Krim from The Independent. And this man becomes charmed by Ted and how he treats people and how he cares, genuinely cares for people. It's as if Ted has been reading our gospel lesson this morning, in which Paul, well, not our New Testament lesson, not gospel, in which Paul lays out some guidelines for relationships to the church in Ephesus. Listen to them again. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it might benefit those who listen. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate and forgive one another. There's really three main themes in what Paul is trying to get across. And I like how he starts not with the things to get rid of, but with a focus on the other. Think about using our words to build others up. That's his first guideline. Using our words to lift and encourage and build other people up. Then he gives us the list of things to get rid of, right? Rage, anger, bitterness, brawling, slander, malice. And then a third guideline, kind. Kind and compassionate and forgiving. Why? Because God forgave us. Kind and compassionate and forgiving. You can tell when someone takes these guidelines to heart. I want to invite you for a moment to think about someone you know in your life who really embodies these. Maybe it's a family member or a friend or a neighbor or a coworker or a church member. Just someone you know who naturally seems to live this out. And then I want you just to think for a moment. How does that person make you feel? When you think about them, do you feel warm and fuzzy? Do you have a respect for them? Do you feel drawn to them? I think this is one of the reasons why the Ted Lasso show has become so wildly popular in a world with a lot of division and anger that gets thrown around between people, especially on our TVs and on our computer screens. The way Ted Lasso treats people is like a refreshing breeze of something different. Paul laid out these relationship guidelines for us who claim to be believers in Jesus so that we could be countercultural, so that our behavior would set us apart and it would show other people that there's a different way out there than the way that everybody normally operates. The way of love in Jesus and how things can look so different when we operate in this way, when we respond to people in this way, rather than give in to our default gut instinct with people, which is often to deflect or to get even, right? There's a scene in the 8th episode of season 1 that I think really exemplifies how Ted approaches relationships. Rebecca is the owner of this football club, AFC Richmond, and she and the team and the coaches are out at one of the neighborhood pubs when her ex-husband, Rupert, comes in with his new girlfriend, a much younger model of his ex-wife, also named Rebecca. Rupert lost the team to Rebecca in the divorce. It was his most prized possession. And he has figured out a way to still sort of get in there. He is financing the younger Rebecca to be a minority owner in the team so that Rupert can come to the owner's box at games and really cause problems for his ex-wife, right? He's a stand-up guy, isn't he? Rupert thinks he has Ted all figured out, and he challenges Ted to a game of darts for a sum of money that Ted cannot hope to bet against him. And so Ted sort of turns it around. Ted says that if Rupert wins, Rupert can pick the starting lineup for the team for the last two games of the season. And if Ted wins, Rupert has to stay out of the owner's box for as long as Rebecca owns the team. So let's see what happens.
You know, Rupert, guys have underestimated me my entire life. And for years, I never understood why. It used to really bother me. But then one day, I was driving my little boy to school, and I saw this quote by Walt Whitman. It was painted on the wall there. It said, "Be curious, not judgmental." And I like that. So I get back in my car, and I'm driving to work. And all of a sudden, it hits me. All them fellas that used to belittle me, not a single one of them were curious. You know, they thought they had everything all figured out, and so they judged everything, and they judged everyone. And I realized that they're underestimating me. Who I was had nothing to do with it. Because if they were curious, they would ask questions, you know? Questions like, "Have you played a lot of darts, Ted?" Which I would have answered, "Yes, sir." Every Sunday afternoon at a sports bar with my father from age 10 till I was 16 when he passed away. Barbecue sauce.
Ted, as it turns out, is not a rookie when it comes to darts. And I love that quote from Walt Whitman. Be curious, not judgmental. The people who judged Ted in his life, who belittled him and made fun of the way that he operates, none of them were curious. They had already judged him, especially Rupert in this scenario. And you can see even Rebecca's face during this scene, realizing that she doesn't have Ted all figured out either. There's things she's learning about him. Nobody had ever asked Ted questions, sure that they were right in their perception and judgment of him. How many times a day do we go around judging people? We do it almost automatically. If we're honest, we do it constantly. We like to slot people into categories in our heads because it helps us make sense of the world around us and it helps us feel a little more secure. We're constantly assessing and judging the people that we come into contact with. We're making all kinds of assumptions about them based on the way that they are dressed, the cars they drive, the way they talk, and so much more. But we don't know what's going on with them or what they're really like based on our observations of them or maybe the small snippets of interaction that we have with them. We judge in our heads and we move on. And we do it automatically without really thinking about it. And often that means that we overlook and ignore people without ever learning about them, maybe without even learning their name. Have you ever been overlooked or underestimated by other people? How did that make you feel? What did it mean to you when someone really saw you? When they took the time to get to know you and understand you, or at least give you a chance? It's easy to judge. It is more difficult to understand. Understanding requires compassion, patience, and a willingness to believe that good hearts sometimes choose poor methods. Through judging, we separate ourselves from other people. But in striving to understand, we can grow closer together. The truth is this: we never know what is going on with someone behind closed doors. Even when we're with them, if they present as happy and laughing, there can still be pain and hurt on the inside that's indescribable. So even when other people around you are not, we can choose to be kind. We can choose to live into these relationship guidelines from Ephesians. We can choose to be curious and not judgmental. And when we do, it is amazing to discover how many of the assumptions that we make about other people are wrong. Ted's ability to see people and to ask questions, it is so different than the constant judgment that we in society tend to automatically engage in. And slowly throughout the episodes of this series, you see that Ted's behavior has an effect on people. It starts to change the culture of the football club. It starts to change the way they interact with one another on the field and off of the field. Ted Lasso notices people. He's curious about them. What if we turned to wonder when we are dealing with other people? Why are they acting that way? What has happened to make them respond in this? What might be going on underneath the surface? And think about the impact it would have if we were curious and we really tried to see and understand the people who are around us. You don't have to look far to see what kind of an impact that might have. You can just open the Bible and read through any of the Gospels, because this is what Jesus taught us. This is what Jesus embodied. He embraced the people that the religious leaders of the day had judged and had written off. Gentiles, Samaritans, Roman soldiers, prostitutes, tax collectors, lepers, the poor, widows, orphans, the physically ill and crippled, the mentally ill, and a whole lot more. Jesus' way of relating to people, of seeing them and loving them, offered them hope of something different. So many who'd been pushed aside and ignored flocked to him in droves. Ted Lasso might be fiction, but he's reinforcing for us an important lesson that Jesus taught us first: that we are all made in the image of God and people of worth and value. That none of us is beyond grace, and all of us are welcome at God's table. As the band comes back up this morning, I just want us to take a moment to think about, what do we do now? What would it be like for us to turn to wonder instead of judgment? To be curious about people, rather than just assume we know who and what they are from the little snippet we see before we shove them into a box with a label. Who can you see this week as you go throughout your days and help them be seen and known and welcome? Think about the difference that that might make for them. As I was working on putting this message together this week, I saw a meme on social media I wanted to share with you this morning, and I want us to say it aloud together, because it kind of helps reinforce this point. Be curious, not judgmental. Will you read it with me? God, help me never to make false assumptions about people I've never met, circumstances I've never known, and events I've never experienced. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for this day, for this time, for this reminder about being curious and not judgmental. Help us through your Holy Spirit to live into that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.